This year, Robert Alfonso Taft is making his second attempt to gain the Republican nomination for president. With the encouragement, assistance, and strong support of his sharp-witted wife, Martha Bowers Taft, the senior senator from Ohio has put up an impressive campaign battle with no loss of his characteristic imperturbability. Though for the past 10 years, Senator Taft has spent most of his time at his house in Washington, he has been a lifelong resident of Cincinnati, Ohio, where he was born in 1889. On the outskirts of the city, he maintains his permanent home, Sky Farm, a 15-room house on 60 acres of land. From early childhood, young Bob lived in a political atmosphere. In 1909, his father, William Howard Taft, became the 26th President of the United States. The elder Taft, who later held the office of Chief Justice of the Supreme Court for 8 years, handed down many of his political precepts to his son. Robert Taft was elected to the U.S. Senate in 1938, after a career devoted to the practice of law and service in the state legislature. His business day in Washington begins soon after 8 o'clock, when he leaves for his Senate office. He often puts in 18 hours at a stretch. During his 10-year career on Capitol Hill, Taft's Republican colleagues in the Senate had come to regard him as their leader in domestic legislation because of his store of information and his clarity of mind. He has always been outspoken on controversial issues. Before Pearl Harbor, he was a consistent isolationist and strongly opposed to selective service. He resisted every pre-war effort to build up the armed services beyond the minimum strength he believed necessary to defend the nation's shores.
Everyone is in favor of an adequate defense program. But the president says that we must not only prepare to defend our own shores, but also to defend various ideals, including good faith among nations. The logical conclusion would seem to be another war with American troops again sent overseas.
Though Taft gave full support to the administration's conduct of the war, the handling of government price controls after the war became one of his principal concerns. He believed that price restrictions were interfering with the American system of free enterprise, and that removal of them would bring more goods into the market and force prices down. Giving weight to his argument was the black market, which was diverting much of the nation's food and other commodities into illegitimate channels. Principal target of Taft's criticism of OPA was its administrator, Chester Bowles, who was firmly convinced that price controls could be made to work. But in mid-1946, Bowles lost out, and price controls were all but eliminated by passage of a law based largely on Taft's proposals.
I helped draft the original OPA legislation, and I've always supported price control. But the controls have become so stringent and complex that today in many industries, the little businessman can't do business without a loss at all. The result has been to force the thing into the black market. First meat, then eggs, potatoes, all control of food threatens to break down. In meat it's so bad, I don't know that there's anything to do except to take the control off meat altogether and simply try to control it through improved rationing. At least the people would get some meat and they'd pay less than they do in the black market today.
Senator Taft, chairman of the Republican Steering Committee, has been the leader in drafting his party's program of domestic legislation. Typical of his conscientious approach to his work is his record on federal aid for education. Strongly opposed to any such measure at first, Taft became convinced, upon closer study of conditions prevalent among the poor states, that federal grants to raise educational standards were badly needed. This conviction he wrote into a bill which, this spring, won the support of the Senate.
We Republicans and Democrats seated here have joined in introducing a bill to give federal aid to the states to enable them to improve their educational systems. The bill is based on the theory that every child in the United States shall have the opportunity given by a minimum education, no matter how poor the state in which he may live or how poor the district in which he may live.
As one of the sponsors of the Taft-Ellender-Wagner housing bill, Senator Taft aligned himself on the liberal side of one of the most important and hotly disputed questions of the day. The senior senator from Ohio, a strong advocate of such social measures as public housing, has long urged upon his party the necessity for a constructive housing program, including prompt action on slum clearance. Differing with conservative Republicans like Ohio's junior senator, John Bricker, Taft bucked the powerful real estate lobby in putting his name to a bill designed to help remedy the nation's post-war housing muddle. Today, Taft is most closely associated with the Labor Relations Act, which bears his name, the Taft-Hartley Act, which he sponsored in the Senate and which became a law over the president's veto. Taft maintained that his bill was not anti-labor and did nothing to impair any essential rights of the working man. Nevertheless, it has made him the target of bitter attack by virtually every union leader in the land. And it has greatly lessened his chance of gaining any labor support, despite his repeated claim that he has the working man's best interests at heart.
This council affirms its belief in the strength, the character, and the rights of the American working man. His pride in himself, his aim to get for himself a bank account, an insurance policy, a home of his own with a self-reliant American family in it, his right to organize and bargain collectively through agents of his own free choice. We denounce the political effort to reduce labor in the United States to the European level of a class-conscious, vote-shackled proletariat. We reject the doctrine that the American workman's mind must be made up in Washington and his personal life turned over to the management of Washington's political coddlers. The destiny of American labor is not fascist. It must remain American.
Bob Taft first became a candidate for the presidential nomination in the Republican Convention of 1940, where, by the fifth ballot, he was still holding on a close second. But by the sixth ballot, with the final swing toward Wilkie gathering too much momentum to be checked, the big rush to climb on the bandwagon eliminated Taft's last remaining hopes for the candidacy. In the 1944 Republican convention, Taft stepped aside to allow Bricker to run for the nomination. But though not a candidate, Taft kept himself well to the forefront in the convention activities. Serving in the important post of chairman of the Resolutions Committee, he played a major part in formulating the 1944 Republican platform. Today, after 10 years in the political limelight, during which he has come to be the acknowledged Republican leader on all domestic issues, Taft feels that he has an excellent chance to win the Republican nomination. Even though his duties as a senator have prevented him from stumping the country as extensively as some of his rivals, Taft has waged a vigorous, if somewhat limited, campaign. But busy as he has been during these past hectic months, Bob Taft has not forgotten how to relax. Unruffled by any last-minute pressures, he is content to let his record in the Senate serve as a recommendation for his nomination.